On the 2nd of December 1919, theatre tycoon Ambrose Small was hard at work in his office at the Grand Opera House on Adelaide Street West. The day before, he'd sold his empire and deposited a massive $1 million cheque into his personal account. The attorney of Ambrose, F.W.M. Flock, was also in the office that evening. He was the last person to see the millionaire alive. Just after 6 p.m., after finishing up for the day, Ambrose locked his office up and bought a newspaper from a stand. Turning up the velvet collar on his jacket against the chill winter air, he disappeared into the night, never to be seen again. The tabloids dubbed it crime of the century, but there is no evidence that a crime was the cause of his disappearance. And Ambrose himself never made an attempt to withdraw the huge amount of money he had deposited into his account. Ambrose Small was born January the 11th, 1863 in Brantford, Ontario, to Daniel Small and Ellen Brazil. An ambitious and intelligent child, Ambrose was 17 when his father moved the family to Toronto, where he had agreed to run the Grand Hotel on Adelaide Street West. Ambrose had his start in the theatre industry across the laneway from his father's hotel by taking customers' tickets, running the bar, and ushering patrons to their seats. A shrewd and ruthless businessman, he quickly rose to treasurer of the Grand Opera House, but a fight with the owner caused him to leave for the vaudeville Toronto Opera House. Despite a reputation as a reckless gambler and womanizer, Small slowly but surely edged his way into management and over the next decade worked his way to chairman of the Canadian Theatrical Managers Association, buying theatres across Ontario and amassing a huge personal fortune. Ambrose loved not only money, chasing women was also something he took just as seriously. His easiest conquests were the chorus girls from his theatres, who he sweetened up with chocolates before finally seducing them in a secret room at the theatre, which was furnished with a monstrous bed, fully stocked bar, and paintings of nude women in suggestive poses. Without curbing his lecherous ways, he married the daughter of his stepmother, Teresa Corman. Teresa's parents were very wealthy, and the newlyweds could look forward to a very handsome inheritance. Ambrose continued to have affairs after his nuptials, his wife being very much aware of his indiscretions. Ambrose was small and thin in appearance, described as hawk-like by the Milwaukee Journal in the years after his disappearance. His trademark mustache made him easily recognizable to people in the street. His long-suffering secretary and right-hand man, John Doughty, was only paid a meager $45 a week, at a time when Ambrose was among Toronto's wealthiest men, a testimony to the tycoon's parsimonious personality. In 1919, Ambrose sold his theatre empire to Trans-Canada Theatre Limited for a massive $1.7 million, $1 million of which was paid in a single check which he deposited at the Dominion Bank a day before his disappearance. Norman J. O'Flynn, the bank clerk, recalled Ambrose being in a cheery mood when he approached the counter. Said Mr. O'Flynn, "It was all over in a matter of moments. I reached for a deposit slip and gasped when I saw the amount of the check." The next day, Ambrose vanished, leaving no trace or clue to his whereabouts. Any leads the police might have had in the first days were missed when it took Teresa Small a full 2 weeks to report her husband missing. Her statement to the police was that she assumed Ambrose was simply out enjoying his fortune with one of his chorus girls. Mrs. Small initially offered a $500 reward for information concerning his whereabouts. The police, thinking it might be a case of kidnapping, convinced her to increase the amount to $50,000, the highest ever reward offered in Canada at the time. But no ransom was ever made. In the two-week period before Ambrose was reported missing, John Doherty, the trusted friend and personal secretary, accepted a new position in Montreal, moving to a boarding house in the city, but went on the run when word of his former employer's mysterious vanishing became an international sensation. The police would later find out that Doherty had visited the personal vault of Ambrose twice on the day of his disappearance and had stolen $150,000 in bonds. Eleven months later, in November 1920, John Doherty was picked up working under a false name by a local police officer in Oregon City, Oregon. Doherty led police to the missing bonds that he had hidden in his sister's attic. He claimed the money was a pay bonus that was to be approved by Ambrose. The authorities, of course, didn't believe him, and he was sentenced to 6 years in jail for larceny. Despite threats and offers of a reduced sentence for information, police were never able to charge Doherty in connection with Ambrose's disappearance. The fortune involved is perhaps the most obvious motive for any crime, if indeed one took place in the case of Ambrose Small. The tycoon's will, dated September 6, 1903, left all $2 million of his real estate and personal property solely to his wife. After several years of attesting the will, his sisters Gertrude and Florence were also awarded $100,000. After Teresa's death in 1936, a sensational claim was published by Patrick Sullivan, owner of the Toronto tabloid The Thunderer, and Ambrose's sisters in order to prevent the distribution of Ambrose Small's estate. It was claimed that Teresa had paid an assassin $20,000 to kill her husband, and even signed a confession before her death. The alleged killer came forward claiming Teresa persuaded him to go on in with the murder. The appointed judge declared the confession a forgery. When the will was finally settled in 1954, there was just $141,000 left. Ambrose's sister, Gertrude Small, didn't have much time to enjoy her inheritance. She drowned, seated beside her husband, when their car plunged into the Nottawasaga River in Wasaga Beach just days after their wedding. Alex McCarthy, a veteran cop who investigated the case, told the Saskatoon Star Phoenix in 1959,
"We had many letters from various parts of the United States and Canada offering information of one kind and another in connection with the case. Many have been from cranks, but all those that appeared genuine have been investigated. They produced no result."
On December the 4th, 1960, Toronto police officially closed and discarded the 3-foot-thick file on Ambrose Small. To this day, his disappearance remains unsolved. Well, my friends, I hope you liked this offering. Yes, my thoughts on this case are, I do believe that Ambrose was probably murdered. Doesn't seem to be much doubt that he was done away with. I don't think he would commit suicide and leave all that money. It wasn't just the $1 million that had been deposited into the bank, but it was also a matter of an extra $750,000 to be paid in installments by the entrepreneurs that he sold his business empire to. So that's a lot of money that he didn't come back and collect. And it's well known that he had enemies. He wasn't a well-liked man. He was quite a hard-nosed businessman. Collected a few enemies. Doughty. Did he do it? He took some money. Seems to be more of a petty criminal. I'm wondering whether, if some other persons involved, maybe an organization, might have done it. It's all just speculation. There was a lot of fingers pointed at his wife because she knew about his affairs, etc. He hated Catholics. She was a devout Catholic. And she was going to donate all the money to the Catholic Church after her death, which caused an uproar. I don't know why. I can't remember exact details of the case, but then they started accusing her of being involved. But I don't know. No, I don't know. I think maybe he was involved in shady dealings and he might have reneged on some business deal and they've got him. I don't think Doughty killed him. I could be wrong. Anyway, I'll leave it for you to think and mull it over. Oh yes, in a few days I have a bonus coming for you. I'm going to show you how my videos are constructed. Behind the curtains, the skeleton of my videos. Some of you might be interested to see that. And I think that's about it. Is there anything else? One more thing before I go. Stay tuned for a blooper. I really had difficulty with this word. You might have a laugh at this. Bye bye. She drowned, seated beside her husband when their car plunged into the She drowned, seated beside her husband when their car plunged into the Nottawasaga River. Can anyone say that word for me? Because I can't. Okay. She drowned. She drowned, seated beside her husband when their car plunged into the I'm going to have to stop this and look that word up. I just can't get it. Hang on.